Good morning. Welcome to Power Talk Live on Power 106 and on Jamaica News Network, JNN. We combine radio and television to give you the best in public affairs discourse. Stay tuned. Later on this morning, after the bottom line with Raston Hammond of Real Business, our co-host, we join Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns, the opposition spokesperson on land and environment, and environmentalist Hugh Dixon of the South Trelawney Environment Association. They join us on the telephone to discuss the environment crisis that exists in South Trelawney with the prospect of bauxite mining wrecking the entire way of life of those communities. A matter of controversy, the need for accommodation, and fulsome discussion. Stay tuned in Power Talk, for Power Talk Live. Raston, greetings.
Morning, Ronnie. How are you doing?
I'm well, thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation last night. I was watching it on CBM.
Okay.
But I wondered whether you might want to expand a little on it, because in assessing the role of the new central bank governor, who is pictured going to his office on the front page of the Observer today, the urgency of correcting what you call the broken financial transmission systems in the country,
yes,
didn't seem to be as much in the forefront of certainly Mr. Noel from the Bank of Nova Scotia, with whom you were partnered,
yes,
or the hosts, who didn't seem to be well versed. That seems to me to be the most urgent task that faces Richard Byles, would you say?
Immediately, I agree with you 100%. The two most important challenges facing the central bank governor at this particular point in time is fixing the broken monetary transmission mechanism and to reduce the volatility in the exchange rate, because those things are having a deleterious impact on the ability of businesses to plan and to expand and to grow the economy faster and to create more jobs and to save and generate more foreign exchange, which are the things that are most important at this particular point in time to improve the resilience of the economy in face of the global recession. We just saw a survey, National Association of Business Economists in the US, 77% of those economists say they expect a recession by the end of this year.
77%.
Early next year. Yes, so it's, yes, overwhelming.
Yes. We're getting to that in a moment.
Yes.
But then you see, your view of the primary tasks for the Bank of Jamaica Governor Richard Byles seems at odds with the expressions of this gentleman from Africa, Mr. Longwena,
yes,
from the IMF,
yes,
who yesterday afternoon, also on RJ Gleaner Media, was giving the rosiest picture of our capacity to withstand any resilience and the remarkable odyssey of our journey, which we acknowledge.
Yes.
But not a word on the difficulties being faced negotiating the financial system by the majority of people who are, after all, the majority participants in the entire financial apparatus by virtue of their payment of taxes, their savings, and ought to be the prime beneficiaries of the financial system, to which they have very little, if any, access.
And that is why I pointed out that Mr. Byles has to make the transition mentally to the point where he now understands that he's the people's banker rather than the banker's
banker.
You
did say that very clearly.
Yeah. So why do we say that? When we look at what is happening, he's now going to be presiding over a financial system where, as at the end of March, the people of Jamaica deposited $1.1 billion of their dollars in that system.
$1.1 trillion.
$1.1 trillion of their dollars.
Trillion, yes. Trillion listeners, yes, viewers, to Power Talk Live.
Yes, that's $1,000 billion in that system. The total assets of that system, $1.5 trillion. That's 75% of the value of the Jamaican economy. As at the end of that period, the loan book was only $730 billion. You with me?
So it's a half.
Yes.
Half of the money, yes, that we put down,
yes,
with the banks,
yes,
in order to use prudentially for the development of our lives,
yes,
and to move Jamaica,
yes,
forward. A half of it is loaned.
Yes, right.
And
here what is happening now. The members of the micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises sector, the people,
yes,
who run poor people business,
yes,
they only get 11.7%.
Of that half?
Of that half.
$700 billion.
Yes, yes. Of that $730 billion, they only get $80 billion to borrow.
Okay.
Yes, that's.
But they are supposed to be the locomotive.
Precisely.
They are supposed to be the innovative element.
Precisely.
Not the already established businesses.
Precisely. Let's go forward. They account for 40% of the output in the economy and 80% of the employment in the economy, but they only get 4% of the credit that is available in the economy.
4%?
Yes.
Did you say?
Yes. So the value of the 80 billion is 4% of GDP.
Oh, I
so
see.
Although they contribute 40% of GDP, they only get 4% of GDP in credit.
Yeah. So that is that feeds in then to the issue that is raised in the excellent editorial in the Gleaner this morning, which indicates that we really, when we're looking at poverty, we should rather look more closely at the issue of inequality.
Precisely.
Yes, and that is an issue which politicians and people of means in the society, by and large, don't wish to face.
Yes.
It is a central issue, not a new one.
Yes.
It is a central issue that has, in fact, been forefront and ignored, suppressed, elevated out of existence since slavery.
Yes. Most certainly, unless we face that, then we're not going to have the accelerated economic growth and the peace and the harmony that we're talking about.
You know, I'm obliged.
Yes.
You gave some figures there that I'm inviting conscious people who are listening or watching this program to take down again. $1.5 trillion.
The assets of the system.
Assets of the financial system.
The money that we deposit, $1.1 trillion.
$1.1, that's actually the depositors' money.
Yes.
That's the savings accounts, whatever else.
The loan book, $730 billion.
The loan book is $730 billion.
Yes.
And of that,
small businesses get only $80
billion. $80 billion, which is what? 11%?
11.7%.
Okay.
Right.
MSM.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Small, medium, micro.
Yes. They account for 40% of the output.
40%
of the output in the country.
Of GDP.
Yes. 80% of the employment.
80% of employment.
Yes.
But 4%
of the credit. That 80 billion is 4% of the credit. Now, look at another
thing. How do you get development which is inclusive with that kind of chronic imbalance and inequality, sir?
That's a fundamental problem, and that's a problem that we need to solve. And those are the things that are supposed to be at the forefront of Mr. Biles' agenda. Additionally, that money that we're talking about, that 1.1 trillion in deposits, BNS and NCB controls 839 billion of that amount, or 83%.
83% is BNS?
And
NCB. Yes, okay.
Similarly, in terms of the loan book, BNS is 157 billion, NCB is 287 billion, that's 60% of the loan book.
Uh-huh.
In terms of the assets, BNS is 410 billion, NCB is $573 billion.
Yes.
So it tells you about the lopsided nature of the banking system, which Mr. Biles is going to be the supervisor of.
Well, it also tells you about the extraordinary responsibility and trusteeship that ought to exist with those who have more.
Precisely.
Is it out of place when discussing these matters of finance and economy to say that to whom more is given?
Which is required of, yes, most certainly.
Yeah.
Most certainly.
And that is a reality that I don't think the people of Jamaica know.
Yes.
Yes. And it's not that when anybody is vexed with them, it's not that anybody is jealous of them.
Yes.
Yes. They can have as much as they can digest. Okay, that's very finite. But if they don't own this, they are trustees of it.
Yes.
For the rest of us who put it there.
Yes.
And it's time that the people of the country, will you follow me, who are the major depositors of that, see that money being used with greater prudence and flexibility to build the economy, rather than to keep us in this slough of barely 1 or 1.5% growth a year, and to face daily, especially at back to school time, the specter of increasing, not decreasing poverty, even as the fetid sound system of the state dares to debase language and spirit by talking about prosperity.
Yes. Another important issue that a central banker will have to face quickly is the volatility in the exchange rate.
Really?
Yes.
Seems to have settled on around 135.
But we know we have these bouts of volatility, then we have these small periods of settlement, and then we move back to the same situation again. One thing that we have to realize, there are people, particularly those who are poor, whose the major use of money for them is as a medium of exchange. To buy food, to buy school books.
Pay school fees.
To pay school fees.
Auxiliary fees.
Precisely. While there are those who hoard money as a store of value.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. So what we want the central
bank... Hoard somebody else's money, usually.
Yes. Yes.
As a store of
a
value.
A store of value.
Which, of course, the store of value means that when you choose to crack the ceiling.
Precisely.
And convert it into pounds or US dollars.
Yes.
Then your value is increasing.
Yes.
But the value of those who put the money in, not so much or not at
precisely.
All.
Precisely. Precisely. Yes.
The system set up bad in our
eyes. Yes, bad. And it needs fundamental reform. And nobody wants to bail that
out. I don't know of the political will.
To deal with it.
Either in the JLP or the PNP to do this.
Yes.
The scripture says, he who reaps fully will have no excess. And he who reaps less will have no lack. That's a principle.
Yes.
That I think we ought to move towards.
Well,
so Mr. Valls then has, according to you and very correctly and rationally, his work cut out for
precisely.
Him.
Precisely.
How will you evaluate him?
Well, the biggest part of the journey for him is to mentally make the transition as to whether he is the people's banker, it is the people who are now going to pay him, or whether he is the banker's banker.
Some people will say, look, don't expect too much, because in fact he's presiding over a system which is bigger than him, and the rules of which are well settled prior to his coming,
yes.
And that in fact do not accommodate, however much his intentions might support what you are saying, do not simply support or allow that kind of maneuver.
That's rational. That's plausible. That's rational and plausible.
Which increases, yes. It ought not to cause depression,
yes.
Or despair, but rather increases the national responsibility.
Precisely.
To place the pressure on those who have the authority, such as the governor of the Bank of Jamaica,
yes.
The Minister of Finance,
yes.
The opposition spokesperson, and indeed all of us.
Yes.
Increases the responsibility to rethink the entire system based upon.
Yes.
The clear objectives,
yes.
That all in the country deserve, yes. To have achieved.
Precisely. So the whole move towards independence must not only be an administrative
independence
thing,
of the central bank.
Yes. But must be to look at the mechanics of the system and how the central bank operates within the Jamaican context. They are not going to go as deep.
We discuss the fundamentals where others might not. We encourage others to understand everyone, to understand the dynamics of the system that governs how much we earn, how much we can spend, how much many of us get to eat and to do the other necessities of life. This is the bottom line on Power Talk Live, and we soon come back. Welcome back to Power Talk Live. This is the bottom line with Ralston Hammond and myself. I submit to you for comment, you alone, the issue of the Integrity Commission, which has gazetted two reports of the assets of the Prime Minister of Jamaica and the leader of the opposition, and which in today's press, Tuesday, the 20th of August, indicates that a serious error was made in at least one.
Yes.
An error for which there was ample time for correction, which appears not to have been done.
Yes.
What does this say?
Well, the people of Jamaica, everywhere I go, from Emancipation Park to Butterfield Park in Real Mona, the people are saying that they are questioning the competence and the integrity of the Integrity Commission. The major issue for that is that they are saying everyone in Jamaica, based on the housing problem in Jamaica, is cognizant about real estate prices. And the people have been questioning how could the Integrity Commission sign off on the leader of the opposition saying that his real estate is valued at $3.6 million, and then came the Prime Minister's own at $7 million. Many people right across Jamaica, those who are educated, uneducated, saw that as extremely foolish and felt that the system, in a word, was taking them for fools. So what we're seeing is that many people have lost confidence in institutions like those. So what we are now seeing is that the Phillips family are saying that the Integrity Commission basically misquoted them or miscalculated. They tried to correct it. The Integrity Commission never carried out the correction and gazetted it. Now, it forces the people to question the competence of the Integrity Commission, not only in terms of integrity, but in terms of accountability, in terms of probity, in terms of cognizance as to what is happening in the economy, in terms of real estate prices. So these institutions which have been set up to enhance confidence in the system, the people are fast losing confidence in the system because of the way these institutions are carrying out their functions in an incompetent way, and well, that is bad for the system.
Over the weekend, Mrs. Johnson-Smith, the minister, says we must give them time to get set because they're new. Is that a reasonable excuse?
No, that's not a plausible excuse. These are people who are supposed to be competent people in their professions. They have a whole lot of experience. So that's not an excuse. Many people believe that they are compromised, the people in the street, and that is why they cannot act in a way that enhances confidence. And whether it's a perception or not, once the people do not have confidence in these institutions, then we are going to have a problem, a deeper problem as a country, where people believe that corruption is just another thing.
Going back to the issue then of the Gleaner's contention about inequality, may I ask your comment on the following quote? There is a vast amount of research worldwide which demonstrates the widening inequality in a society weakens social capital and undermines social cohesion. Growing inequality tends to lower GDP growth over the medium term and feeds instability, crime, and corruption.
Yes,
given the nature of the Jamaican society, the government should have every incentive to want to know the impact of its policies on income distribution.
No sensible person would question that.
Many do.
Well,
many claim that the plight of the majority of people, as they did Queen Victoria's letter,
yes,
before 1865, was that's it's your fault.
Yes.
Yes. If you fail,
yes,
it's a dominant amoral and philosophical position in many parts of the United States administration at the present time.
Yes.
And therefore, don't you speak to me about income inequality. You go out and pull up your own bootstraps.
Okay.
That is in the souls of many of our people, as well as many abroad.
Yes.
Yes. So it has to be addressed.
Our response to those people is that when you sit on your verandas and talk about the uncertainty in the global economy, when you sit on your verandas and talk about the criminality and you're afraid to come below Tarrington Bridge, think about...
Tarrington Bridge is far.
Yes.
Crossroads.
Yes. Okay. Think about the system that you are presiding over. If you had more people with opportunities in that system, if you had more people with opportunities to work and to fully actualize themselves and become sustainable consumers, then you'll be making more money and you'll have a more harmonious system. So if your objective is to make more money, the more people you bring productively in the system is the more money you can make. This is why we are having all of these recession fears now, particularly because of that philosophy.
But if, going back to your original set of statistics this morning on the financial system,
yes,
I don't really need to be philanthropic and to think about inequality on my veranda, sir. I'm
yes.
doing very well because the system is stacked in my favor, even
yes.
though I won't admit it.
Yes, but you could even do better.
Well,
if you fix the system and you'll be able to come below crossroads.
Well,
if you fix the system.
Those people. But this is, I'm being snide
yes.
for the moment to make the point, but
yes.
this is an issue
yes.
that really faces us,
yes.
that the whole direction of discourse about the economy
yes.
in Jamaica
yes.
has to shift now just
yes.
from broad notions of growth.
Yes.
Yes. And having regard to the way that the structures are set,
yes.
it has to shift now to the issue of equality of
yes.
opportunity
yes.
and in great measure equality of outcome.
Right.
May I give you a practical example?
Yes.
The Minister of Labour, Mrs. Robinson, who tries very hard,
yes.
Indicated a figure, I think it was 700 million, that was being distributed to the hundreds of thousands of students
yes.
who are on PATH.
Yes.
Yes. And everyone feels, my goodness, isn't this nice? This is social reconstruction.
Yes.
But the fact is that when you divide it per head, it's about $3,000.
Yes.
Now, with the greatest of respect, $3,000 can barely buy one textbook.
Right.
Yes. In a family which, by definition, which by definition is unable to do that,
yes,
being on path, and which those not on path, earning a 7,000 a week.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
60-odd% of our workforce.
Right.
Simply can't afford the appurtenances necessary,
yes,
to take advantage, to pull themselves up by the same bootstraps, even though some of them don't have shoes.
Right.
With any straps.
Precisely.
Now, this is the conundrum that we face.
Right.
And it surely we are better than many others.
Yes.
Elsewhere in the world.
Right.
But we are not nearly as good as we could be with our 1.5, let's work it right back, eh? To where we started, or $1.5 trillion worth of assets,
yes,
or $1.1 trillion worth of
deposits.
Of deposits, yes.
Yes? Yes.
And the breakdown into the strivings, the efforts, the industry, the enterprises of the ordinary people.
Precisely.
Of this land.
Yes.
So, this is where everything comes around, doesn't it?
Precisely.
Well, okay, and just so that we can complete the picture, here we have all of this is taking place in Jamaica with all of its anxieties,
right,
in the context of our closeness to and dependence on the United States economy.
Yes.
Where although Mr. Trump and others are saying there's no such thing as a recession for us. We,
yes,
are in, the economy is buzzing,
yes,
which in many respects the figures support.
Yes.
They are preparing in the back rooms,
yes,
for exactly that.
Yes.
Yes.
Also,
and they're speaking of payroll tax cuts.
Yes, precisely.
Yes.
Yes.
And of a reduction of tariffs.
Yes.
Is this going to work, I ask you, one? And two, what parallels, if any, are there with our situation in Jamaica?
Well, the sustainability of those measures are questionable because the fundamental causes of the slowdown in the global economy now are trade-related. So as long as the president continues to pursue this trade war with China, no amount of stimulus from the Federal Reserve Board is going to help the economy. The longer the trade war goes on, it is the more the Fed is going to be using up its ammunition uselessly. Now, across the Atlantic, there's the similar problem. If there's a Brexit without a trade deal, it is going to have a significant deleterious impact on the Eurozone economy. Now, we want our listeners to understand, when we talk about the Eurozone economy, that economy is 22% of the entire world economy.
Yes.
The American economy is another 21% of the entire, that's 43% of the world economy.
Yeah.
And China is 15.4% of the world economy.
So you don't have.
Yeah, so we've gone over 60% of the world economy. They are also our major trading partners. So the spillover effect must hit Jamaica.
What prudentially should we do?
Well,
we should, first of all, we should have some discourse about it, shouldn't
precisely.
We? Which has barely started, yes, if at all.
Precisely.
Yes?
Yeah, that's one. That's okay. The first layer.
Good to have a national broadcast, you know, Nigel.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And it has to do with back to school,
yes,
too,
yes.
Ministers.
Yes.
Because it's going to affect what kind of things we expect our people to,
yes,
become competent,
yes,
to do,
yes,
that will help us to stand in good stead.
Yes.
When this liquors down. Apart from what Mr. Nguama says,
yes,
that we are in a good position. Surely we're in a better, yes, position than we were 6 years ago or in 2008. And we're grateful for
the
that.
The American economy is also in a better position than 2008, and, right, that could be the epicenter of the recession.
Right. So there you are. So having said that, and glad that we have a little bit more,
yes,
hurricane shutters,
yes,
in place, metaphorically, we still have to be mindful and not. It's not to be pessimistic or,
yes,
to be overcritical,
yes,
to say that these are things. These are headwinds which we face, and we better deal with them.
Yes,
yes. In which case, the issue of the bauxite industry,
yes,
the issue of the trade-off that we make,
yes,
between breaking up,
yes,
an entire way of life in the parishes of North St. Elizabeth, South Trelawney, and parts of Western St. Anne becomes very, very acute.
Right.
That's selling us out for a mess of pottage.
Precisely.
Remember what happened in the Bible?
Right. And it's also important to note that, as you spoke about in the Bible, it's something more current. In 2008, the Great Recession, the bauxite and alumina industry was the first one to collapse.
Oh dear.
Please remember that, Jamaica.
So when we come back on Power Talk Live, We'll be joined on the telephone by Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns, the opposition spokesperson on the environment, and Mr. Hugh Dixon, one of the most stalwart campaigners for the integrity of the environment and the way of life of South Trelawney. He says he has no friends in Parliament, that they are preparing for a battle with the administration. Is that inevitable? What are the options? Stay tuned to Power Talk Live. This is Power Talk Live on Power 106. Thanks for joining Raston Hammond and myself. Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns, good morning. Is she on? Mr. Hugh Dixon, are you there?
I'm here, Mr. Fraser. Are you hearing me, sir?
We apparently have to wait on our guests so that we can see whether we can continue this discussion. Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns, morning.
Morning, morning. How are you? Good morning, Mr. Dixon.
Is he on? Is Mr. Dixon there?
Yes, I heard him earlier.
Okay. Hugh Dixon.
Yes, sir.
Okay, morning to you both. Very well, and may I link you, Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns. You've greeted Mr. Dixon. Raston Hammond of Real Business is the co-host of this program.
Morning, Sophia. Morning, you.
How are you?
Morning. I'm good.
Mr. Dixon, you stated recently that the cause of the cockpit country and to save it from the spoiling of the environment, you have no allies in Parliament. The battle lines thicken in the cockpit country dispute. Sophia, are you an ally or not?
I certainly like to think that we are an ally.
Okay. Hugh Dixon, are you despairing that some of us might not rally to your cause? There are some who feel that there should be no bauxite mining in South Trelawney, Northern St. Elizabeth, and the remainder of the western part of St. Anne that has not already been despoiled. Where lies the struggle now? Are you despairing?
I'm despairing, Mr. Fitz, and let me give some credit on this phone line to those listening in the studio that may be fully involved and sit elsewhere and may feel offended by my comments. But let me put it this way, sir. I believe that when I think of what has transpired in recent times, and I have to shift gears a bit, Mr. Fitz, in September 2018, the Mines and Geology Department of the government issued a license to Noranda to start mining. Yes? The one caveat that is holding the thing from happening is that the environmental impact assessment, which is a precondition for starting mining when you apply to the NEPA for a license, has not yet been done. Okay, so they have in their hand a license. In March of this year, based on what we have as reports, the Noranda started to, in fact, encroach on what has been stipulated as the mining lease area 173 and was mining. So NEPA had to send a cessation letter to them to say, no, you have encroached by our monitoring system. Yes? Stop doing it. Yes? And they had to write a letter to say to them that they were not entitled to a lease at this point because the environmental impact assessment is further to that. Further to that, so it's, and my colleagues listening. They have not issued the EIA, which I'm told is already submitted to NEPA, and there's a delay in issuing it so that the public can see what was done by Conrad Douglas and Associates to get a feedback from the teacher in up to time to get us clear on the impact of this particular debacle on the Jamaican people, especially here in the country, and the impact of mining which will come. Now, I think that with that kind of information, I'm fearful because Noranda said it without fail that on the 19th of September 2019, they intended the mining.
19th of September.
Okay.
Okay, that's 1 month from yesterday. Yes.
From yesterday.
Yes.
Yes, sir. have not heard anything from the Her Majesty's opposition in the parliament. I don't see anybody out here that has come to look at the conditions and understand the dilemma. And clearly the government is in hiding because they are procrastinating and holding off in time to make it closer to the 19th of September.
Thank you.
So what else do we know? Just quickly, pardon me if I'm a little bit emotional about it. The fact is that there are agreements, yes, because Miranda had a change of ownership, and there are agreements about what they have paid off, what they have paid into the government of Jamaica, in light of the start of the process. So from an economic standpoint, which I want to hit on critically this morning, we have a situation where our government is tied by the fact that it has gone ahead and made some agreements, yes, because I spoke to you last time to talk about agreements. Fast forward, agreement. Yes, so there is obviously some payout already. The point, though, is that what we are up against, Mr. Flitch, is about to damage existing industry because our water is going to be affected. We know about that, and it's going to affect our tourism, which is a major income earner. And we are on that. We are faced with that. I don't know how tight is this 19th of September arrangement that Miranda felt obliged to tell us in the spring that they intend to start mining. And I don't know how long NEPA and the government of Jamaica is going to hold that EIA from us so we can look at it and give feedback, whether that is just sheer protocol and face card for us, because they have gone through already and made an agreement. So I'm worried, sir.
Okay. No, pause that. You have a reason to be. Your way of life is at risk.
Yes.
Sophia Fraser-Binns, what's your comment on that? Does Mr. Dixon's fear represent the position of the opposition?
Let me start off by saying that we, the opposition, we were actually involved in lobbying the government and encouraging the government to first defend the cockpit country boundaries. Let me start off by saying that. And we have, I recall in 2017, when the Prime Minister announced the boundaries of the cockpit country, he indicated to the nation that we were happy that an effort was made to defend the cockpit country boundaries. The fact remains that we would have wanted it to be more extensive. We have wanted to work. Now, having said that, we have continued to watch the proceedings. Now, since the matter has come to the fore in terms of... Hello?
Yes, we're hearing you. And some other people, too.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, we are.
Yes, I'm so sorry about that. My little family just entered the room. I'm so sorry.
No, we're happy for him. Go ahead.
Yes, sorry about that. Right. Since the matter of the man in the corporate country that has come to the of the nation and indeed the opposition, we have sought to intervene. So what we have done is we have, for example, we issued a statement calling for a halt to all mining. But outside of that, we had a stakeholder meeting with all interest groups involved in the mining, involved in the corporate country protection. Admittedly, not everyone could attend. I do believe that an invitation was extended to Mr. Dixon himself. The fact remains that there are some things that Mr. Dixon has said that are correct. Having declared the cockpit country protected area boundary, the government issued a license in 2018 to Miranda to commence bauxite mining, and that license is 2173. Prior to that, another was issued, 172. Now, in terms of 172, which impacts areas such as Gibraltar, that mining license is in active operation, and there are issues surrounding the operation of that in terms of the dust nuisance and the effects that we have on the community. And we have been working with members in the community to see how best we can seek some redress for that. But I think the heart of the issue for Mr. Dixon lies with mining license 173, which impacts the cockpit country. There are two issues here. One is that when one looks at 173, it impacts the broader cockpit country, what we know as cockpit country, but does not include the what the
Prime Minister calls the Cockpit Country protected area. And so part of the issue which we understand, which we are also speaking about, is the fact that even outside of the Cockpit Country protected area, there are areas which are part of the Cockpit Country as we know it, which 173 covers and which would allow for mining. So that's one issue. The second issue is that 173 has been given, the license permit has been given by the Mines and Geology Department. He was correct in saying that NEPA that has to give an environmental permit before mining can commence has written, well, wrote to say that that license ought not to have been given and requested an environmental impact assessment. The information we have received is that the environmental impact assessment has been completed.
Yes, it has.
But we have not heard anything about it. And as you are aware, the Act provides that there's a process that has one has to go through in terms of the environmental impact assessment before it can be fully accepted and before mining can commence. And that is where our focus is on. What where is happening, because we have been speaking to interest groups in the Cockpit Country, and we were hoping that we will get involved in that, what you call, voluntary consultation, that consultation process, because that consultation process has to be undertaken by NEPA before the EIA can be accepted. And that is where I believe that most persons who have an interest in the Cockpit Country will have an opportunity to speak and to impact. I mean, let me just say one other thing, which I believe it is something that is impacting on interest in the Cockpit Country, is that even though Naranda has claimed that it has not commenced mining in its real form, in its true form, what Naranda has done is Naranda has built access roads.
Okay.
In pursuit of
it's preparing.
That in and of itself is a problem for us.
Senator,
we have been speaking about it, and I whereas I, you know, Mr. Dixon has his views in terms of no friends or allies, the opposition has been trumpeting this, and the leader of the opposition just 2 weeks ago spoke about it. As I said, we had our consultation with stakeholders. We continue to speak with stakeholders. We continue to see what we can do to impact and to effect change in the interest of preserving the Cockpit Country and the residents in and around the Cockpit Country.
Senator Binns, I believe there is a resolution on the order paper of Parliament that calls for no mining whatever in South Trelawney, in the curtilage of what is known as mining lease 173. Would the PNP support that?
Absolutely.
Right.
You know,
good.
The opposition has always been about protecting the environment. Let me just say that out. We have always been about protecting the environment, and we believe that such a resolution is timely and must be debated post-haste. But if you allow me, Ronnie, I want to say something else. What this conversation about the Cockpit Country has brought to the fore is a wider discussion that I have spoken about. I know the leader of the opposition has spoken about it. I know you yourself have spoken about it, and Michael Stewart, MP from South Manchester, has spoken about it, that we need to look at a cost-benefit analysis of
yes.
Cost-benefit mining.
Yes.
The time
yes.
has come for us to go beyond
yes.
the fact that we know we get some US dollars. And
yes.
we're grateful for that.
Yes.
But we have to look at how does mining affect the country on the whole.
So you'd fully support that.
And the whole health. And that's one of the things that we have to know. Discuss.
Well,
we can't just look at it in a vacuum.
Well, coming to you, Mr. Dixon, may I just say that there is a resolution in Parliament also calling for precisely that analysis of the cost-benefit analysis, of cost-benefits to Jamaica of the bauxite industry, which is being suppressed by the government and unfortunately still remains languishing. When we come back on Power Talk Live, can we hear from Ralston Hyman of his assessment as an economist on whether bauxite is in fact beneficial to the economy of Jamaica? And of course, Mr. Dixon, your turn for rejoinder on all that you've heard so far. This is Power Talk Live on JNN and Power Talk soon, and Power 106. Soon come. Talking with Senator Sophia Fraser-Binns, the opposition spokesperson on environment, Mr. Hugh Dixon of the South Trelawney Environment Association. Ralston Hyman, what is the economy of bauxite? Will we make more money if Norando and their successors go ahead with mining lease number 173 and all those that will follow? Or is there another way to achieve prosperity in that region?
When we look at the performance of the sector, for example, when we look at the gross foreign exchange earnings, and we say gross because the highest level we have ever reached for the sector is $1 billion. That is gross. There's no analysis or calculation as to how much of that is left in Jamaica. So we know about tourism that we have hyped to about 41%. There's no study as to the net effect of the bauxite and alumina sector in terms of foreign exchange.
And we've largely given up the levy.
We have given up the levy.
And are depending on some profit sharing. And I don't know if, when she speaks again, if Sophia Fraser-Binns knows how much we're earning from the profit sharing with that company or any company.
Well, we never benefited much from the profit sharing during the 60s and the 70s.
No, that was why we changed
the levy in 74.
Yeah.
Now we have gone back to that. In an environment where aluminum and alumina prices are falling,
okay.
For example, when we look at the environmental degradation in terms of our land in the country, when we look at the impact on our people, we see the people demonstrating nightly on the television about the environmental degradation, the poisoning, the dusting up of their houses and all of those things. We believe that when we look at it on a per acre basis, putting all of that into consideration, we believe moving to the agricultural sector would be more sustainable for the country in the long run, and that would generate more foreign exchange from that sector, and it would be a win-win situation for all our people.
Hugh Dixon, what are your thoughts?
So, thanks for that, Ralston, because the numbers are hard to come by when you're rurally based like I am.
Yeah.
But let me put some practical things to you. Let's take the tourism industry, which Ralston just said provides net 40%. Is it that figure?
And that's high.
I run Coptic Country Adventure Tours, which is involved as a small community enterprise to start tourism here. I must admit it grows incrementally with every year since we have had it in place. Now, what we have tried to do is replicate the model in a number of communities. So there is an environmental nature-based eco-attraction in Bunkers Hill. There's one in the Alps. We have one in Spring Garden and Rock Spring. And by my experience with this small community enterprise, if the government of Jamaica took an effort to monitor the community-based enterprises in tourism, that I'm associated with, including my own, you would find the potential to increase the tourism dollar to Jamaica by twice within a three-year period based on the figures that I could bring from my small entity. And why am I saying this is because in the very same place that the government of Jamaica plans to mine bauxite over the next 5 years in 173, out in Balaclava and going all the way up around the neck of Coptic Country. I have been to those communities and found they all offer attractions of ecotourism, community-based tourism, and experiential lifestyle tourism that would enable the current crop of visitors coming into Jamaica to spend more out of their wallets by going to those. But if we had near government involvement in pushing this, we would begin to bring the tourism dollar into communities where the farmer can get it, so he would increase his, from his yam production, the visitation by a guest to see him produce it, and the byproducts that come from it. The homestay, the accommodations, the people who have their houses, we have a homestay where people have bed and breakfast, and our visitors come there. I can give you the figures. They come, they spend time, they spend their money in the communities. They want to learn the culture. Mr. Faith, that is what we're digging out. Yes? And nobody, and I'm saying it loud and clear, nobody in the government and the opposition comes into these communities to investigate the potential for that. We have a new governor going into the bank and needs some autonomy and independence, and like the independence we are seeking out here in these communities. Where is the creativity? Where is the energy? Where is the will to come and look at these ventures and put a five-year plan together that says, listen, we don't have to go to the IMF. We can increase or expenditure. It's an export. Tourism is an export, but the expanding area is in eco-community and experiential tourism. Where are our people governing this country and serving as representatives to the people? Where are they in terms of putting out our university graduates to come out here and investigate that and put together an economic plan that you've got to rely on? Jamaica has a brand name that sells anywhere in the world. Right? We have infrastructure already in place, so you're not looking at infrastructural investment to get an uplift. And you have pristine environment left here.
Mr. Dixon, you've made your case. Senator Fraser-Binns, what's the next move you think we ought to take?
Let me just say that the opposition will be visiting some of the communities in the in the conflict country this month. And we'll be doing that to some of the stakeholders with whom we have been in ongoing contact. So that's the first thing. Secondly, in terms of the cost benefit, it is something that we support. I heard a talk about the farmers, and it is true. We have visited communities in St. Elizabeth. We have visited, my team and I have visited communities in St. Anne, in Gibraltar, in Barnstable. We have seen it with our eyes. We have heard what the residents have shared. I remember one of the times we visited a community in Southwest St. Anne, and this gentleman showed us a part of his land that he agreed that he sold to Narando with an agreement that they would have reclaimed it. And we know the situation when it comes to land reclamation.
Yes,
and
terrible.
He lamented to us that every time it rains, he loses a piece of his land to landslide. We have seen it. We actually, on his behalf, intervened with Narando, who undertook to go in and do some rehabilitation work for that resident. So not everything we do, we have publicized, and perhaps there's a negative side to not publicizing, but we have been in touch with the communities. We have been working. Valentine Wind, who is the chair of my environmental subcommittee, has been working in that community, ongoing, working with the residents to see how we can assist in changing their lifestyle. We have gone
Senator.
We have made representation in terms of land tightening and the need to ensure that persons in backside communities do not have to wait 40 and 50 years more to get tackled for poverty. Where
good.
They have
Senator, can I ask a particular question? Will you be calling for the immediate release of the Conrad Douglas environmental impact assessment?
Absolutely. And we're quite prepared to make that call today because we think it is something that must be made public. The environmental impact assessment is something that is normally made public. And we believe that this one must be made public, that the consultation must be done, that the residents must have an opportunity to give their views, to let their voices be heard, and that the government has a duty, an obligation even, to listen to the residents in these communities.
Very good. Mr. Hugh Dixon, what will happen on the 19th of September if the mining begins?
Well, Mr. Faith, what will happen on the 19th of September? If the government continues to trick us as it has been doing and continues to remain in silence without notifying us or contacting us, on the 19th of September, the heavy equipment will start to build haul roads into 173 and begin to get the ore out to get Naranda's capacity up from, 2.6 million metric tons per year to 5.2 million metric tons per year.
Okay.
I'm not praying for a recession, but I have to pray that there is a fall in the bauxite prices to prevent the need for that kind of excessive mining of bauxite out of here. To give our own government the chance to have wisdom and say, let us put an economic plan together, because if we save that soil and the trails that I'm looking at, that exists, where the mining is going to take us a place in a place. Where foreigners will come and want to see, and we can show them, and then leave them dollars here as an export that is sustainable over time.
Tell me one thing before time runs out on that, Mr. Hugh Dixon. What would mining, as you have seen it in other parts of Jamaica, if it came into your community,
What would it do to the area?
To it, because I'm looking at the dust that is going to affect my livelihood, my children, and the whole lot of communities here. I'm looking at the farmers who have the independence over the many years, taking out their yams and exporting it and bringing back $28 million to this country every year, having nothing to plant, and having to move forward into the cockpit country to seek out new land in the area that the government calls the cockpit country protected area boundary, because they have juxtaposed the mining area next door to it and has left out the area that is the transition zone and the buffer zone. So we are losing the whole of it once the mining starts there on the 19th of September.
Thank you very much for Ms. Strong.
The government of Jamaica and the opposition needs to know that. And it can't be trite about releasing an EIA. It must be about engaging the people at the level of their existence on the streets and putting an economic plan together that spares us from the debacle that will come to an end in 30 years.
I love the strength and the radicalism, Senator Sophia Fraser-Vince. Thank you for your advocacy on behalf of the people who are possibly going to be affected. Thank you both very much for this.
You're welcome.
Yes.
Later to have a further discussion on this.
I hope you will. That'll be good. Thank you very much. And this is what we can do on Power Talk Live today. Thanks very much to our co-host Raston Hammond, to our guests, and we hope that you have been enlightened by our discussion. Join us next time.